My original plan for today was to share some AMD Ryzen 9000 CPU benchmarks with you guys, but since AMD has delayed that launch by a little over a week, we're gonna need to wait for that. And I guess speculate on whether it's a problem with the CPUs themselves or just a typo, Ryzen 9 9700X? We're still waiting for confirmation on if this was what caused the delay or if it was something more fundamental, but fortunately, we have a backup plan. It's time for me to get probed.
Excellent.
Today's video is brought to you by the Corsair K65 Plus Wireless RGB Keyboard, featuring silky smooth pre-lubricated Corsair MLX red mechanical switches, two layers of sound dampening for softened typing acoustics, AES encrypted connectivity via low latency 2.4 GHz wireless, Bluetooth or USB wired, a multi-purpose rotary dial with function key combos and shortcut commands, resilient PBT dye sublimated keycaps, and of course, per-key RGB lighting effects, which are endlessly customizable in Corsair's IQ software. For more on the Corsair K65 Plus, click the sponsor link in the video description. That's right, this is Probing Paul, episode number 88 for July 2024. A few notes before we dive in. There's a Probing Paul playlist. If you'd like to delve back into all the times I've been probed in the past, you can't even see the white mode that used to exist so long ago. Feel free to leave your questions in the comment section down below, and perhaps I will answer them in the next episode. I gathered a few from the last episode, as well as some of the more recent videos that people have posted questions on, but Probing Paul also includes mail time on occasion. I'm not doing that today, but a reminder, if you guys want to send me something to open on the show, send it to Paul's Hardware, P.O. Box 4325, Diamond Bar, California. And in the next episode, I will include mail time as well. But let's dive into our first question, which came from Quadraporacone, who was recently watching videos, mine and I assume some others, on this Intel processor debacle, the ongoing situation with Raptor Lake and Raptor Lake refresh CPUs, 13th and 14th gen Intel processors. If you haven't already watched it, check out the Gamers Nexus video on this subject. Steve and his team have been very on top of the situation. That's an interesting freeze frame that I captured. But to summarize, high voltages as well as oxidation over time seems to be the driving force behind a much higher failure rate for 13th gen and 14th gen CPUs, particularly on the desktop side, but it also affects mobile as well. And a lot of people who either are planning to purchase one of these CPUs or who maybe already have one are just in a situation where they're like, what do I do now? Is my CPU going to fail or not? So I'm going to focus on answering this question with the best advice I have for now for people who are in this situation, like Quadraporacone. They are in the process of building a midlife crisis dream PC, and they've gone with a Heights Y70 case, an MSI S360 all-in-1 liquid cooler, MSI Z790 godlike motherboard, a Corsair DDR5 64 gig kit, actually a couple of those for 128 gigs total. One quick note here is I'd recommend a 2x64 gig kit versus two 2x32 gig kits if you can find that. And a quick aside, not to get too distracted, but you're probably gonna have an easier time setting up a 2 DIMM configuration versus a 4 DIMM configuration. Of course, 2x64 gig kits are difficult to find right now, if not impossible. You can find DDR5 2x48 gig kits, maybe consider that as an option. But again, I'm getting distracted. The 4060 Ti 16 gig is not that great of a graphics card, so I'm glad that you're planning to upgrade to a 4090. Because this card just doesn't match with this build at all, and we have a crazy overpowered power supply, 1300 watts. You don't need that much wattage, even for a 4090, just FYI. But again, I'm getting distracted. Let's get back to my core advice of what people should do if they have or are planning to buy a 13th or 14th gen CPU. And my assumption here is that you'd be pairing something like a 14900K or 14900KF with this build, since it's got pretty high-end components otherwise. Quadraporacone, I think you have two options. One would be to simply ditch, return, or sell on the secondary market your MSI Meg Z790 motherboard, switch over to an X670 motherboard, and pair that with a 7800X3D, which is pretty widely regarded as the best gaming CPU right now. If you need higher core count because you're going to do some heavy lifting with the system besides just gaming, then the 7950X3D would be the alternative choice there. But for some people, when the answer is just don't do Intel, do AMD instead, they're like, actually, I really want to do Intel. And again, my advice would be to switch to AMD at this point if you're planning on building this type of system. But if you absolutely have to go Intel and you want to build on this platform, then the 12900K is where I would point you to. And it's down to $300. Like, that's a pretty good deal. The 12900K is Alder Lake versus Raptor Lake. It's a little bit slower, but not that much slower. So that'd be my advice specifically for Quadraporacone if they don't want to ditch their Z790 motherboard. Because as Steve has pointed out, Intel's response to this issue right now has been pretty underwhelming, and we're still waiting on more specific details for them about what kind of support they're going to be providing people whose CPUs fail, and also just some better guidance on which CPUs are affected. If they have managed to correct this issue on the manufacturing side, then there will be a certain cutoff point where newer CPUs are okay and older CPUs are not. They need to provide us batch numbers so we can identify which CPUs are affected. In the meantime, for anyone who is already running 13th or 14th gen Raptor Lake or Raptor Lake refresh CPUs, you should absolutely go to your motherboard manufacturer's website, download the latest BIOS, and update that so you get the latest microcode patch updates. That is your best bet to gain a bit of peace of mind right now. And beyond that, we're waiting for some more information on Intel, which they have promised by mid-August, which hopefully comes sooner rather than later. Likewise, again, as pointed out by Gamers Nexus, there is going to be a snafu situation on the secondary market because the CPUs have already been identified as not as stable or as reliable as Intel's track record in the past would lead people to believe. And of course, if you start to experience any of the instability issues that have been reported by the tech media, then apply for an RMA immediately. Intel has at least indicated, although not in as strong as language as we would prefer, that they will be supporting their customers who have problems. So hopefully that provides you with a couple different possible avenues to go down quadrupoticone. Again, my core advice here would be opt for AM5 if you're building new right now, although as mentioned at the beginning of the video, you might want to wait a week or two for these new CPUs to launch and see how they perform, especially if your focus is on gaming. Next question from Ashgupta854. Hey Paul, my apartment is very dusty. I feel you there. We get a lot of dust around here as well. Even though I clean my PC every couple months with a can of compressed air, the internals remain very dusty, practically baked onto the motherboard and other components. The case is a Corsair 200R. Magnetic dust filters have been added to the back and the sides. So if you, like Ash, deal with a lot of dust and it collects in your case very easily, can you solve that with like a new case, for example? And I would say to a certain degree, yes. If you get a case that has easily accessible dust filters, then you can clean them regularly, and that's the best way to keep the dust out of your case. Because once filters start to get dust caked on, then the air is going to seek other ways around the filters to get into your case, perhaps around the dust filtration so the dust doesn't get caught. And that's how more dust is going to end up inside your case and on your components than captured by the dust filters. One thing you could possibly do is to run your case fans at the lowest RPM that you're comfortable with based on how hot your internal components, specifically your CPU, GPU, maybe your motherboard VRMs are getting. If you can monitor those while running your fans at lower speeds, while also gaming or otherwise putting a significant load on your system, then that can help you find that balance between airflow and reducing the dust that builds up. But even more so than the case options, I would encourage you to perhaps combat the root of the issue, which is just the fact that you have lots of dust in your room. And for that, consider an air purifier. I'm not going to recommend a specific one or anything like that. There are, of course, a ton of them available on Amazon, so I will leave it up to the reviews or perhaps external reviews for actually locating which air purifier might be right for you. But grabbing something like this and keeping it running 24/7 or perhaps at regular intervals in the room where your PC is will help greatly reduce the amount of dust in the air and hopefully also the amount of dust that's collected by your PC. My last bit of advice would be to treat the room that your PC is in like a computer case itself. Set up like a box fan or something, if you can also provide some dust filtration for that in a window to positively pressurize the room to force dust out in other areas, that combined with the dust filter is probably going to get you the best dust-free environment in the room with your PC and reduce not just the amount of dust in your PC, but also the amount of dust and debris that you're breathing in, which is good for your health. Next question from Richard Harrison 1493. I have a build question. Most YouTubers concentrate on gaming builds. Can you provide a build for the everyday user? Surfing the web, watching streaming services, some retro gaming perhaps with an N64 or PS2 emulator, nothing flashy. You got me, Richard, guilty as charged. I am totally one of the tech YouTubers who typically recommends gaming PC builds and not too much besides that. And that's because the things that you're talking about doing are things that are now easily handled by a cell phone or a laptop or even a very small mini PC like the Intel Nooks that I guess Asus now does those now. Desktop gaming PC builds are typically larger and a bit more cumbersome and not quite as felt and put together as like a nice sleek laptop. And that is because they need to maintain interoperability standards. So you can say, here's an ATX motherboard that's gonna work in a bunch of ATX cases. The same would go for the power supply and other standardized components inside a typical PC build. And also with a desktop PC, you're gonna get a lot more power. You don't necessarily need a lot more power to do stuff like surfing the web, watch streaming services, or running emulators, but for more intense workloads, whether you're talking about workstation stuff or gaming, you're gonna need more power if you wanna hit high refresh rates and do all the high-end gaming stuff like pairing that with a high refresh rate, high resolution monitor. You would not be the first one to ask me about recommending a build for this type of purpose, but when people have asked me that, I've either said, get yourself a entry-level laptop for $300-$400. It's gonna get the job done, includes a monitor and a keyboard, and not involve the amount of costs or investment of time for building that a typical full gaming PC would require. Or check out the crazy variety of mini PCs on the market, because these will typically still offer some level of upgradability, whether it's by adding more memory or potentially more storage. And I'm just gonna toss out a handful of mini PC makers that I've worked with to some degree in the past, starting with Zotac. They have a huge variety of these. They've got both Intel and AMD solutions. They also have a huge variety of systems, some with cool features like an LCD display on the side. GMK Tech is another one that has gotten pretty good reviews. I haven't worked with them directly, but again, basing this on external reviews. And also B-Link with the really tiny PCs. Because these PCs, they get the job done. They're all contained. They have nice features like expandability ports and everything. You can just attach these to the back of a TV or a monitor and you're off to the races. So for anyone looking for a system like Richard is asking for, that's the direction I would point you towards. Cute little mini PCs. We got time for one more question from ChadPainter8705. Thank you very much for watching my series. I'd love an answer to a question that is really quite hard to find on YouTube. External USB DAC or sound card, which is better and why? What is the best bang for the buck? And they're talking specifically for speaker use and not headphones. Now, let me start off by saying that I am not incredibly familiar with the vast array of audiophile class technology that's out there. It is absolutely a rabbit hole, but once you do get a setup going, or if you have the opportunity to try out like a friend's setup who has that audiophile taste, and you can put on a really nice pair of headphones and listen to like super audio CD, FLAC, lossless audio quality recording, especially for like a really nice track. It is quite an experience and maybe worth the money depending on what level of investment you're talking about. But I can answer your question on a bit of a fundamental level. External USB DAC or sound card? Absolutely, you should go external USB DAC if you're trying to veer into the audiophile space. The internals of a typical PC are very electrically noisy. And especially for an analog signal, you do not want any interference of that kind. So taking the digital signal outside of the PC and letting the digital to audio conversion happen with a dedicated device is absolutely the way you should go. And I would say don't even consider internal sound card options. Your motherboard's built-in audio is functionally good enough for most people until you reach the level where you want an external DAC. And also when you reach that level, you should start checking out some other channels besides mine that actually focus on that type of stuff, such as Brian over at Bad Seed Tech. He does excellent videos. I'm gonna link his video from the end of 2023 about the best starter DAC and amps for your money in 2024. He has some great feedback. The awesome thing about his video, this one in particular, is that all of the different units he tried are all quite good. There's excellent competition in this market space. And for around $150 to $200, there's some really good choices, such as the iFi Zen DAC V2, which is only around $200 if you purchase it on Amazon right now. But again, check out Brian's video for a lot more information and check out his entire channel. Subscribe to Brian. He makes excellent content and I wish I could figure out how he does his lighting because it looks way better than mine. But guys, that's gonna wrap it up for this July installment of Probing Paul, my monthly Q&A series. Again, if you wanna send me something, send it over to my PO box, which is in the video's description down below. I'll also post links to Brian's channel as well as other stuff I talked about down in that video description. While you're down there, if you wanna hit the thumbs up button, that helps me out greatly. And if you're not already subscribed, to my YouTube channel, consider doing that too. I've got some AMD content on their new CPUs, hopefully, theoretically, coming out really soon. And I'll also be resuming my tech news series this Sunday. Closing reminder to check out my store at paulshardware.net where you can buy shirts, mugs, pint glasses, and all manner of high quality merchandise. Thanks again for watching this video, you guys, and we'll see you in the next one.